All right. Hello, everybody. I'm back. I just found out that I'm introducing people here, so I'm figuring this out on the fly. Our next speaker is going to follow up on Emil's presentation. This is Kim Goodspeed from Ultragenyx, and she's going to provide more information about the Ultragenyx trial.
All right. Hello, everybody. Emil set the stage really nicely. So what we're going to do now is go through the data. So I'm Kim Goodspeed. I am a child neurologist by training. Neurodevelopmental disabilities was my specialty. I am actually new to Ultragenyx, so I can't take credit for this data. This data belongs to the patients and the PIs who collected it and contributed, and the teams at Ultragenyx that were part of that team that, ran those trials. But I'm really delighted and excited about the data, and I'm really happy to share it with you today. So similarly, we need to remember this is an investigational drug. It is not approved. This is all preliminary data, or not preliminary data, but data from a phase 1/2 study that was open label. So it was not a controlled study, like what Emil just talked about, having a group that's treated and a group that's not treated. Everybody on this trial knew they were getting treatment. And so the concern is always, if you know you're getting treatment, you might feel a little better, look a little better, or the data might look a little nicer. So we always have to remember that. But this is how we do phase 1/2 studies, as we get a good understanding, what do we think it looks like? And then we get to go into that confirmatory study and really assess the risk-benefit profile of something. The other thing to note is that we do have some caregiver quotes in here. They're meant to be illustrative. They're meant to be examples of what this looks like in the real world. So when we say a Bayley cognition score has changed, what could that potentially look like in your house? What has it looked like in somebody else's house? But it's not meant to say this is what every child would look like who is on drug. And again, none of this would be possible without all the people who contributed. So first and foremost, your kids who went through all the things to make this data possible. You who made that possible to come to all of the visits and fill out all the surveys again and again and again. And then all of our sites and all of their teams behind the scenes. It takes a ton of people to make these things run. Okay, so y'all have heard about this a lot over the last few days. I'm going to go through this a little bit quickly. But what this is showing you is how our ASO is working. So that antisense oligonucleotide. We've got mom's copy in pink. We're focusing on the deletion patients in this particular study, but again, we'll get to those non-deletion patients a little bit later. So the little space in the pink chromosome is referring to the deletion, the missing UBE3A gene. And then the blue chromosome is dad's. And the goal is for our GTX-102 ASO to go and unsilence the silencer. So go and take that antisense transcript out of the connection with dad's chromosome and allow dad's copy of UBE3A to be that supplementary copy. So in our clinical development program, I just like to level set with this slide. I think it's a really nice schematic. You always start with your animal studies. You learn as much as you can from your mice, your monkeys, sometimes pigs, but then you move into your human studies. And in a typical small molecule, you're going to go into a healthy population first as a phase 1 study, and then into your population of interest as your safety study in your phase 2. In rare disease, and especially in drugs like ASOs or gene therapies, a lot of times we're going into that healthy, or the, excuse me, the population of interest first. So that means our studies are phase 1/2 studies. That's why you hear us call them that. And that means we're looking at safety primarily, but because it's a rare disease and your data is incredibly valuable, we also look at efficacy. How's the drug working? Once you clear that hurdle, you move into your phase 3 study, and that's usually a controlled study. So that's why you see two populations there. You've got a population that gets treated and a population that doesn't get treated. Nobody knows who's on what treatment typically. That's the blinding part. And then you can see what is really contributing from the drug itself. What's an effect of the drug versus just standard of care in some cases? And that phase 4 study is down the pike. So that's after the drug's approved, and you continue to want to see what's the long-term safety and efficacy once it's on the market. So our phase 1/2 study was our first in human study. It was in patients with deletion type Angelman syndrome, ages 4 to up to 18 years old. And it was open label, so everybody knew they were on drug. We assessed several different dosing schemas so that we could learn what's the best one to go forward with in our next study. The next step for these patients is they're going to move into a long-term extension study. And in that study, they will be continue to receive drug, they will continue on open label, and they will continue to contribute data and understand the safety and efficacy profile of GTX-102 in the long-term. So the phase 1-2 study, again, open label, different dosing schemas, but in general, most of the time we were giving 4 monthly loading doses, so those purple arrows, and then every 3 months in the maintenance period, patients would be dosed. We were looking at things that we think matter to your population based on your disease concept study and your natural history study data. So again, thank you for all those contributions, because we already had a good idea of what we needed to measure to say that this is working or not. And our goal was really to focus on that unmet need. There's a lot of seizure medicines out there, but there's not a lot of developmental medicines out there. None, actually, right? We just give you therapy. And so we really wanted to focus on those pieces of Angelman syndrome that are really that real unmet clinical need. And then we're always looking at safety. So here's those kind of blown up. And I think you have heard about a lot of these different measures ad nauseum by this point, and you've experienced them, you've lived them. The Vineland, I know, is everybody's favorite to do. And so we've got cognition, communication, motor disabilities, sleep problems, and behavior problems. And those are all the symptom buckets. And then we can take these different measures to capture and quantify and put numbers to those different symptoms so that we can measure them over time, understand how you were before treatment and how they are after treatment, and be able to compare. And what's nice about this is you're also able to compare across different perspectives. So sometimes it's an assessor with the patient, so doing the Bayley, testing their developmental skills. Sometimes it's your clinician interviewing you, taking your history, understanding what life might look like and trying to do their severity assessment. And then other times it's you as caregivers giving us that feedback directly. What does it look like in your home and in your normal day-to-day lives? And so we get a really good picture with all of these different measures. I know they're burdensome, but it gives such a nice global assessment of how your kids are doing. Maybe we'll advance. Too fast. Okay, so we'll go through the data. So this is the baseline data. This is the potentially boring part. I'm going to liven it up as much as we can, but this is where we start getting numbers and graphs and charts. The main point of this is that we are pulling cohorts that we have the longest term data on, as well as doses that are pretty similar to what we think we're going to go forward with in our phase 3 study. And this baseline is to show that the groups were relatively similar at starting points. And I can tell you they are relatively similar to the natural history groups that we were comparing to as well. And this is a shout out to y'all, because you have contributed all this data that helps us understand our data. And so because y'all have contributed, because y'all have had these ongoing natural history studies, you've had your registry studies, we have a wealth of data to understand what were those measures we should pick on the front end. And how can we know what it could be better? How could we know what an improvement might be? And then how do we know what's meaningful to y'all? So y'all have helped us understand all of that. So first off, Bayley cognition. So this is one of the subtests of the Bayley, and it's essentially the test that's looking at learning, memory, problem solving, and it's that foundation of development. So on the right-hand side of the slide, you see your natural history data. And so what we're looking at across the bottom is the years. So baseline is 0, approximately 1 year out, and then approximately 2 years out. And that dotted green line is a line of statistical significance. So all statistics does is try to understand what could have been happened by chance and what do we think is less likely to have happened by chance. Crossing that green line is less likely to have happened by chance alone and had the effect of something else on it. In this case, we're thinking it's GTX-102. So in your natural history data, you can see that the kids are making some gains over time, but it's relatively slow and relatively flat. And then when we look at our data from the GTX-102, we can see that we are crossing that line of statistical significance at about 6 months and for sure by a year. And so that's suggesting that these kids are gaining skills, gaining points on their Bayley assessment that we don't think they would have gained just by standard of care alone, and we don't think it's by chance. We need to confirm that in our next phase of study, but this is really exciting to us. So what does that mean in your daily lives? What we hear and what you can see in the quote are things that they're just more focused, more engaged. Their attention spans are a little bit longer. And you can imagine if you have a longer attention span in your therapy session, maybe you could get a little more out of that. And so we start to think about how could this look on the longer term? Similar story for receptive communication. So understanding language, processing language, and being able to potentially act on that. Instruction, directions, things like that. Again, we've got our natural history data on the right. So baseline, 1 year out, 2 years out, and that statistically significant line in the dotted green line. And you can see they make some marginal gains, but we're not crossing that line in the natural history data. We are crossing that line of statistical significance by about a year, potentially a little bit earlier. And that improvement is sustained out to about 2 years. And that's about as far out of our data goes right now. And in the daily life, it's like, I think they understand me a little bit better. They seem to be following directions and just a little bit more engaged. And so again, that's one of those important things that could have a safety implication of being able to follow directions, being able to participate at home or even wait their turn. The next two, we're gonna look at the Angelman Severity Assessment Scale, sleep and then behavior. And so this one works a little bit differently. It's a 7-point scale that goes from pretty severe or very severe to mild or neurotypical, almost normal. And so a reduction in your severity score is considered an improvement here. So that's why we see that deflection on that graph. Out at about 6 months, we've got at least a 1-point change. And it's things like nighttime awakening has gone down. Caregiver interruptions or disturbances have gone down. The duration of sleep seems to be better. And so all of this can be so impactful on the entire household. You know, maybe Sib has a big test the next morning and they're getting a better night's sleep now. So sleep, I think, is somewhat underrated, but really important. And then this one is for behavior. And you guys have a lot of challenging behaviors, and each of your kids' behaviors could look a little different from one another, right? And so we're similarly seeing about a 1-point reduction that's pretty sustained response in our longer term data. And it's things like hyperexcitability, overexcitability, being able to be out in public, being able to participate in community activities a little bit better, reduced impulsivity, reduced compulsivity, so those obsessions. So the quote I think is really nice here, especially that everything's a bit more calm. And sometimes you don't realize it's quiet today. And before it was just constant. And so I think that's a really powerful quote to, you don't notice how intense something is until you get a little bit of a reprieve from it. And then this is our multi-domain responder index that Emil did a great job of explaining, but this gives us that big snapshot bird's eye view of how's everybody doing. And you know, I was an autism doctor by training and did a lot of work in different rare diseases. And what's tricky is we want to parcel you all out into these, well, deletion kids do this and UPD kids do that. But at the end of the day, if you've met one kid with autism or Angelman syndrome, you've met one kid with autism or Angelman syndrome, and they're each unique and they each have different struggles. The buckets are the same, but the response may be a little bit different. And so this tool is a really nice tool to be able to capture all of that heterogeneity, all of the differences, the individuality of your kids. So orient you to the graph one more time because I'm a teacher at heart. And so I think repetition is generally good. So you've got sleep, behavior, receptive communication, and cognition as our different buckets. Marching down, we've got each patient line by line in this particular group looking at about 6 month data. And white is going to be no change. Green means that they hit that clinical threshold of what we think would be a meaningful change or surpassed it. And then pink is they got worse. Things did not look as good in that particular measure on that particular child. And if you look over, 20 out of the 24 kids had at least one domain with a positive response. And so it's a really powerful way to be able to say, This drug doesn't work the exact same for every single individual with Angelman syndrome, but I don't think it has to, right? We're targeting the underlying cause. And so we want whatever that underlying issue is to get better for your family. And that may look a little bit different from patient to patient. So safety, we have to talk about safety. This was a safety study. We haven't had any unexpected serious adverse events, but we do have an adverse event of special interest, an AESI, if you ever see that in documentation anywhere. So the adverse event of special interest is lower extremity weakness. In our initial 5 patients who were dosed, they had a much higher dose and a much more rapid escalation on their dosing schema. And all 5 of those patients developed lower extremity weakness. So everything was paused. You get to reassess. You understand what happened. All those patients recovered completely, no sequelae in those patients. And after making some mitigation, so making some changes to the protocol, putting in some additional safety parameters and measures, we were able to come back with a lower dose study with a slower escalation, still see great clinical benefit, and all of these patients have been redosed without recurrence. And we've only had 3 out of all of the rest of the kids that we have dosed since opening back up. And the cases have been a bit more mild. They've all resolved completely again. And 2 of the 3 have gone on to be redosed, and 1 is just pending scheduling. So we understand that you can see safety signals sometimes that you weren't expecting. But now we know what to look for. We know what we're seeing. We know how to manage it. And we know that it hasn't recurred and that these patients have tolerated being redosed and seen clinical benefit again. So we feel like we've got a pretty good handle on it now. And now we get to think about, how does our data look overall and what do we do next? So overall, we've seen long-term benefits, lasting improvements, and a safety profile that we feel very comfortable with. So next are going to be our 3 study. So our plan is to continue with the same type of patient, so same age group, 4 to 17 years old, deletion patients in this pivotal, single well-controlled trial. And as Emil mentioned, it's going to be a double-blinded, randomized, sham-controlled study. What that means is in the schematic down below, that in the purple arrow, patients will come into sites and make sure that all of their clinical parameters look like they could fit and are a reasonable candidate. And then they will be randomly assigned to either the treatment arm or the control arm, and they won't be told which arm they're in. Their PI also won't be told which arm they're in, and a team at Ultragenics won't know which arm they're in. So everybody is blinded. The trial marches on for about a year. And at that point, we allow each participant to go on to the next phase of the study, which was the open label period of the study. If they were in the treatment arm, they just continue on treatment. If they were in the control arm, then they go through the loading doses and the same dosing regimen and escalation up to our goal dose as the control arm or the treatment arm did, excuse me. So what this means is there will be a period of time where half the kids are dosed and half the kids are not getting active treatment. But at the end of the study, everybody is on active treatment. And then at the end of this study, everybody can roll into that long-term extension study until drug is approved in their area. And then we have not left out the other genotypes. I know this is a hot topic and a big concern. We also haven't left out the other age groups. So your mutation patients, your sequence variants, your UPD, ICD, we intend to include all of them in this additional study, and we intend to include other age groups. This study is still being designed right now, and so we appreciate your feedback and input and look forward to opening this one after our 3. So, thanks, guys. So, our outcome measures. We're really proud of our Bayley-4 cognition data. As a developmentalist, I have never seen a performance measure where your kids are actually doing a test with a psychologist change in the confines of a clinical trial. So I think you should be really excited that that's the kind of data your guys are getting to see right now. That's a big deal. But we're also going to look at that bird's eye view. We want to know what it's doing when you look at all the symptoms taken together and understand what everybody is looking like as well. So we're looking at it from a two-pronged approach. We're going with that conventional performance test. It's a very objective measure. It's a strong measure, but the other symptoms matter too. So we are proud of our data. We believe that we are seeing lasting improvements across multiple key aspects of Angelman syndrome that are really unmet clinical needs right now. Our incidence of lower extremity weakness has been substantially reduced since we made all of the additional changes to and mitigation procedures. We believe that we have a positive risk-benefit profile, and so we want to test that in our phase 3 study. And our intent is to open the phase 3 by the end of this year. That additional study for the other genotypes and the other age ranges, our intent is to open that study by 2025. And we anticipate that GTX-102 could be safe and effective in all the populations of Angelman syndrome. So I threw a lot of information at you. We're not going to be able to answer all those questions today. And then you're not going to have all the questions today either. So I want you guys to take a moment as you're thinking through things, processing the conference, write down your questions. Think about them, send them to your ASF members, and we are going to host a webinar in the fall so that we can address all of your concerns. We have an idea of what your questions might be, but we really need to know what your questions are. So please collect those and let us know, and they'll get fed back to us so we can address them all at one time. Thank you so much.
All right. Let's thank Emil and Kim again for providing us all that great information. Thank you very much. All right. So I get to induce the next two speakers, two people that I've been working with in various ways for an awful long time. Becky Crean from Ionis and Lynn Bird, who has been working with by Ionis, but she's with Rady Children's Hospital in San Diego. So they're going to be telling us about the work being done at Ionis.
É muito cara de pau esses gatos, viu? Não aprendeu. Prendeu o nariz dela lá. E eles entram dentro de casa. Eles entraram já. Pequeno ainda.
Hi. Thanks, Jeff, for that extraordinary introduction there. I'm Becky Crane, as you mentioned, with Ionis Pharmaceuticals, and I have the pleasure of leading the project team for our Angelman program at Ionis. And I want to thank the ASF Foundation for inviting us to be here on behalf of myself and the Ionis team and Dr. Lynn Bird. We really are pleased to be here with you today to share some important updates about the trial. So with that, I think I'll get started. All right, so here are my disclosures. All right, so just a brief overview of what we're going to talk about over the next 20 minutes or so. We are going to review, kind of take a step back and look at the design and the goals behind our current HALOS trial. And this is a study that we're looking at ion 582, which is an ASO for potential treatment for Angelman syndrome. We're also going to share with you, Dr. Bird is going to share with you some results from the early part of this trial. The early part is now complete, and we have some really important and exciting data to share with you. And then we'll also talk about next steps. Where do we go from here with this program and what's on the horizon? So that's sort of the agenda for the next few minutes. And just to remind everybody what ion 582 is, you've heard a lot about ASOs. We've been talking about it over the last few days, few years, actually, a lot of excitement in the field with ASOs. And so this particular ion 582 is an ASO that's designed to stop that silencing mechanism on the paternal UBE3A gene. We just heard about how it's the paternal gene that's naturally silenced in people. All of us. And in Angelman, the maternal allele is deleted or mutated in some way, so it doesn't produce the UBE3A protein. So this ASO is designed to unsilence that paternal allele, which would then produce UBE3A protein in the brain. So this particular ASO is a 2'-MO antisense oligonucleotide. We say ASO for short because that's a mouthful. And what it does is it cleaves or cuts off that antisense transcript, which silences the paternal allele. And when you clip that off through a cleaving mechanism, it upregulates that UBE3A protein in the brain. And so you hear a lot about ASOs, but they're not all the same. They have different chemistries involved with them. And so this particular one, as I mentioned, is what's called a 2'-MO. It's just a certain chemistry. I won't go into the details of that, but we use this particular chemistry for its potency, its ability to knock down that antisense transcript, and also for its safety and tolerability properties. And so all of the chemistries have different pluses and minuses and characteristics about them. But at Ionis, we particularly focus on these 2'-MOs for those properties of potency and safety. We have a lot of experience with this particular chemistry. If any of you heard Dr. Brett Moynihan, our president and CEO, talk this morning, he talked about our deep experience in developing ASOs, and particularly with MO ASOs. We have over 14,000 patients treated with this type of chemistry in conditions such as spinal muscular atrophy, ALS, Huntington's disease, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson, and others. So a lot of deep, deep science and foundation work that goes into this type of ASO and therapeutic. So the HALOS trial, we started this trial a couple of years ago with ION 582. It is because it's our first trial in the clinic, it's a phase 1/2 trial. You just heard about why we're able to combine some phases, particularly in rare disease. And this is an example of that. And so it has three parts to it. It's part 1, 2, and 3. And I'll go into a little bit of detail of what that means. It is a global trial. It is an open label trial, which we just heard about that. So everybody's on active drug. And we have a very broad range of the population in the trial. So we have males and females, and we also have ages 2 to 50, and we also have deletion and mutation subtypes in this trial. So we're testing this compound in a pretty broad range in the population. As with most first-in-human trials, the primary goal is assessing safety and tolerability. That's the main focus of these trials. And so they're small trials. You try to do this in the smallest number you can to be able to answer that initial research question, which is it safe and can it be tolerated? So that's the primary focus of the HALOS trials. And of course, we're also taking the opportunity to measure all the important clinical features that are associated with Angelman syndrome. And so we have measures in the trial that will look at things like communication, cognition, motor function. And we do that so that we can really assess every aspect and symptom that might be impacted with a treatment. So what we're going to focus our talk on today is the first part of the HALOS trial, and that's the part one. This is the part where we have 3 months of treatment, and we look at three different doses, and then we do assessments along the way. So in this first part, we had a low, medium, and high dose. And you can see how many participants were involved in each of those doses. And what happened during this first part is they were dosed at day one, month one, and month three, which you can see with the blue triangles on the bottom there. And then once they finished those three doses, then a month later, everybody got assessed with all the clinical outcome assessment measures. That's the green box under month four. Now, the medium and high dose went on at 6 months and had another clinical assessment. So that's the data that we're going to focus on and share with you today, is that 6 month data from this first portion. It's completed now. All of those patients who were eligible moved on to the long-term extension. That's parts two and three. And what that means is it's still open label. Everybody still receives drug. And we just continue to give that drug for a couple of more years. Right now, the study is, I think, three additional years, but we'll plan to keep that open and until the drug is developed. So that'll be the focus of our talk, of Dr. Bird's data presentation today, but also to give you an idea of what exactly we are measuring in there. In addition to safety and tolerability, we're also looking at the key functional areas that are impacted with Angelman syndrome. So we do this in a number of different ways. And what you can see on this table is at the top, you can see what measures we're using. We're using the Bayley-4, the Vineland-3, a measure called the ORCA, and then an Angelman-specific version of the CGI. I'm sure you're very familiar with these. The Bayley and Vineland have been used for years and years in the natural history studies and every interventional trial that's been done in the communities. And you've probably all experienced them yourself. And we are using them in this trial as well. And you can see on the left-hand column going down all the different functional domains that these assessments measure. And they look at how well functioning it is and then how it changes over time. You can see with the green boxes which measures focus on which domains. And you can see there's a lot of overlap with the green. So each measure has some overlap with the different functional domains. And we do that because we really want to get a broad look from a multitude of perspectives of how things might be changing for your loved ones. So we look at direct assessments of function where the clinician, the psychologist actually works with the child and assesses their abilities. And then we also look at the parent's perspective in some of those same domains. So the Vineland and the ORCA asks the parent, how do you think your loved one is doing in these areas? And then we also ask the clinician, their perspective on how the Angelman patient might be changing over time. And so this allows us to get a really broad look at how things might be changing or not from very different perspectives. And it allows us to see consistency in changes over time. Not getting any advancement. Do we have any IT folks here? Oh, there we go. Let me go. All right. So that's a little bit about the design of the trial. And just to set the context for the data that Dr. Bird will share with you, but just to give you an update on where we're headed now that this portion of the trial is over. So the good news is we're going to continue the HALOS trial. That will continue with all the families in it that are currently in it and continue to collect really important safety and efficacy data that will be used to support the program. So all participants and families are in those portions now, and they'll continue on. And as that data continues to mature and we have portions complete, we'll continue to update the community on what those results look like. In the meantime, we're also working with the FDA and gaining alignment on the next phase of development, which would be a phase three. So those meetings are being established, and we hope to meet with them by the end of this year to really understand what our phase three is going to look like. And then the plan would be to initiate a phase three pivotal trial in the first half of next year. So we feel very good about the data that we've collected and the robustness of it. And Dr. Lindberg will share that with you in a moment. And that really sets the stage for us to take this next stage of development for this program. So with that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Bird. Thank you, Becky. It's always good to get the fun part of the talk. Here's my disclosures. I'm a PI on all of the ASO, the three ASO trials, as well as the Roche small molecule trial, and I consult with Ionis on their Angelman program. So as Becky said, there were three doses in the HALOS trial, and you can see the average age as well as the distribution of ages at the top there for each one of the doses. You may notice that there was no attempt to try to match these. All of the adults got into the high dose group. So that's why it's going to be a little tough to try to just compare each one of these to each other. You can see that in each group, there were mostly deletion patients and some mutation patients. That just reflects the percentages of those genotypes in our population. And you can see that of the 51 enrolled patients, all but one completed treatment. The one that discontinued treatment did so for an event that we didn't think was related to drug administration. So 100% of those who completed elected to go on to the long-term extension. We really found that the tolerability of ION582 was really quite good. Nobody discontinued related to study drug. The adverse events that we saw were things that were fairly much expected. So some fever, some vomiting, and some basically cold symptoms. Importantly, no reports of lower leg of leg weakness, ataxia, or any sense that the nerves in the legs were unhappy. So we looked at data at 6 months because that was when we could pool together our patients that were in the medium and high dose group. The low dose group was not assessed at 6 months. They were assessed at 4 months. This group was really just to establish our minimal safety and efficacy group. And the low dose group then went on to get medium dose thereafter. So for the medium and high dose groups, we're pooling this together because having that increase in sample size allows us to have more robust comparisons for the natural history data that we use in comparison. So for all the graphs that you're going to see coming up, the ION582 patients who were treated, so the HALOS patients in the medium and high dose group lumped together, are shown in the magenta bars on the left, and the black bars are what we would expect from natural history. So thanks to this community and its commitment to advancing our knowledge of Angelman syndrome, we have a huge amount of natural history data. So we can use that as comparisons in measures like the Bayley and the Vineland, where we don't know exactly how many points is clinically meaningful, but looking at it in comparison to the natural history really gives us a good sense of that. So on the left is the Bayley 4 receptive communication. So this is how well our folks understand language. And on the right side is, again, receptive communication, understanding of language as measured by the Vineland. So on the left side, the Bayley, the psychologist did the assessment. On the right side, there was an interview of the parents for their impression. And you can see in both cases that the gains we saw far outpaced what we would expect from natural history. Now turning to expressive communication, this was assessed on the Vineland on the left side, the Bayley on the left side, the Vineland in the middle, and the CGI, the Angelman-specific CGI on the right. We don't have natural history data for the CGI, so you don't see that listed there. But what you do see is that there was a change that is in the clinically meaningful range of at least 1 point. And the other two graphs show the difference in what we know from our natural history data. On the ORCA, which was the Angelman-specific communication scale, we have done the data to show what is clinically meaningful, and greater than or equal to 2 points in improvement is felt to be clinically meaningful on the ORCA. And we have a small amount of natural history data because the ORCA is not that old, so we haven't been using it for as long in the natural history study, but we do have a little bit of natural history data, which is shown there. And you can see that there's about a 3.6 point improvement in the ORCA, which far exceeds what you would expect from natural history and meets the bar of at least a 2 point improvement considered to be clinically meaningful. Cognition is shown in this slide, again, compared to the natural history study, the Bayley, and then the measures of cognition on the right side are the clinician's impression on the CGI. And in each case, you can see that we show difference from what you'd expect in the natural history, and the improvement was greater than one point change, in other words, clinically meaningful. This shows that 97% of individuals who were treated with ION582 in the medium and high dose group were felt to have overall improvement in their Angelman syndrome symptoms. So that's as measured by the CGI, the clinical global impression score. And you can see that not everybody improved in every domain, but overall, 97% of individuals were felt to have improved. You can see that the most improvement happened in the domains of cognitive, gross motor, and expressive communication. We had less change in sleep and maladaptive behaviors, and seizures didn't change very much at all. And that probably reflects the fact that you had to have pretty stable seizure control and stable medications to be able to get into this study. So we didn't see seizures changing much. But these are all what we think are clinically meaningful improvements across all domains assessed on the CGI. If we look at the Vineland, same thing, we can see for every domain, we can see that there were improvements in greater than 50% of individuals. And these, again, exceeded what we'd expect for natural history.
This grid just shows the areas that were assessed by the various elements and the areas that we saw greater than 50% improvement in dark green, less than 50% shown in the light green. The ones that are white or blank, those areas weren't assessed by that tool. So you can see that we're seeing a pretty widespread, consistently positive effect here. Caregivers were interviewed to report what they saw, and there was increased focus, increased ability to communicate, increased mobility, getting a good night's sleep, and taking care with more independence, taking care of their own needs. So a lot better shown in green, no change in yellow, and a little bit worse shown in red. So mostly people were seeing improvements. So in summary, we really saw consistent benefits observed with ION582 treatment in individuals with Angelman syndrome. We saw a very favorable safety and tolerability profile on all doses that were tested. We did see some changes in the EEGs that were also encouraging. These data are very complex and need to be looked at a lot more in more depth. And we saw evidence of clinical improvement in all of the key functional areas that are important in Angelman syndrome. So 97% of individuals showed a clinically meaningful improvement overall. And we saw improvements in the Bayley, the Vineland, and the Orca. And the consistency of the benefit seen is all ages and the two genotypes that were tested. So we really think this justifies taking this compound ION582 forward into phase 3 studies. Did you want us to take questions? No. Okay, good.
I just wanted to say thank you on behalf of Ionis to everyone on this slide here. It's not everybody, but it's a start. All of our study sites. This was a global trial based here in the U.S. We had several sites here and then across the globe. It was a tremendous effort on their part to get this trial up and running and completed. And then also, of course, the Angelman Syndrome Foundation. And all of the Angelman communities across the globe. It's just been tremendous to collaborate with you all. It's an important part of our process, and we couldn't do it without you. So for that, I thank you.